Welcome everyone to another episode of AppSec 101. My name is Andrew Garrett, and I work in product marketing here at Micro Focus Fortify. And I'm pleased to be joined today once again by Stan Wisseman. We've had him on a couple of times now, and it's always good to have his experience and background with us. Stan was at Fannie Mae for many years, working in data security over there, and now he's here with us. Stan, we've had you on here a couple times now. It's good to have you on here again.
Good to be back. Thanks for having me. I'm glad you're doing these series.
Yeah, our topic for today is AppSec and QA, why they are better together. The question I'd like to start off with is, you know, are they synonymous? And just a quick example, if you're producing quality software, does that mean it's automatically secure?
So let's first start with, you know, defining what quality and security mean in the context of software development. And let's start with quality first. So quality assurance testing is focused on whether the application is performing the functions that it's supposed to do. Now, by definition, quality software will execute according to the intended design and purpose based on business functionality. You know, the International Standards Organization, or ISO, does have a software quality standard that has a hierarchy of 8 quality characteristics, such as functional suitability, reliability, maintainability, and the ISO standard does identify security as the 5th of the 8 in that set of characteristics they're looking for, which is pretty good. So what about security? Software security is focused on hardening applications and testing to identify software weaknesses that could lead to exploitable vulnerabilities. We want software that won't put systems or data at risk and in some way enable unauthorized access or fall victim to misuse.
Okay. So it sounds to me like you're saying that, you know, if you have quality software, then it will perform, and if it performs as it's designed, and if it's, you know, built securely, then you're going to minimize your risk.
Right.
But then the question is, so how do quality and security relate to each other?
Yeah, it didn't really answer your initial set of questions there, but to lead to that. But you know, software security and QA are both concerned about removing risks. You know, the software security side is really working to remove security risks, and the quality assurance team is trying to remove risks associated with code quality. And if quality software must execute according to intended design on business functionality, and a prime business function means satisfying the end user, the customer, then we must also recognize that vulnerable, insecure software will fail to satisfy that customer expectation, right? I mean, if you end up with delivering vulnerable software, they're not going to be happy with that. And if it fails to please the customer, it's not executing on the intended design and can't be labeled as quality software. You know, that's why I think ISO included security as one of those characteristics. So poor code quality leads to, in some cases, unpredictable behavior. When a QA tester pounds software to perform outside its design purposes, by definition, the function is a quality defect that provides pathways, ultimately, potentially for attackers, because it has a vulnerability. It's not behaving expectedly. So from the user's perspective, it's unpredictable behavior that would be considered poor usability, right? But from an attacker's perspective, it's a weakness in that software that could be exploited.
Okay, so you talk about poor usability. So, you know, in that case, wouldn't the QA team be more motivated to fix security vulnerabilities? Does QA have similar metrics around defects as security?
Good questions. In my experience, when you think about classic quality assurance team members, you know, they struggle with supporting security testing. And it's not really necessarily a fault of them. It just the QA testers and how they typically have behaved are what they do is they're looking at test results matching expected results in their test cases that they previously defined. And in more agile DevOps kind of environments, maybe user stories, right? And most QA testers I've dealt with haven't had that mindset to look for potential misuse or abuse of the application. Now, you raise a good question about metrics and any common ground there. And that's a good question. So if you think about one of the most popular QA metrics is around defect density. And measuring defects allows application owners to assess what level of quality they have in their components at any stage of the SDLC. And that density grade is the number of confirmed defects in a module divided by the number of lines of code in that module or function. So when a density gets above a certain agreed upon threshold, they know they have to take action. And I've seen, you know, a defect density of one or below as being used as a threshold as to what's considered to be quality code. But honestly, each organization sort of has to determine for themselves where they want to draw that line. But on the similar side on security, vulnerability density is a metric that's pretty popular. And you also will see the percent of security defects by sprint or by project. But we should also view security vulnerabilities or security defects as just any other defect that impacts the QA density grade too. So I've seen a number of companies use that to great effect by, you know, just having security defects included in the quality metric. And that really makes a big difference.
Okay. Well, let's talk about defects a little bit more. How can viewing security defects as a code quality issue help prioritize mitigation of security issues?
So you have to look at motivations, right? And so if the dev managers have MBOs, management by objectives, that are aligned to producing high quality application software, you'd like to hope that they also have a MBO around the security of the software, but let's assume they just have one around high quality software. Integrate security into their metrics, either explicitly or implicitly. You know, so that's what I was talking about before. Going back to our code quality defect density metric, if that's in use, the security team needs to jump on it. Make the case that vulnerabilities are just another type of software defect that needs to be tracked, prioritized appropriately, and remediated. Security defects are part of the general defect density equation and impacts dev managers' MBOs. You know, and simply put, if the purpose of development is to make sure that software satisfies customers' needs, then fixing defects, including security defects, should be part of it.
Let me pose this question to you. If software was tested for security vulnerabilities and it passed with flying colors, would that then be deemed quality software?
Not necessarily, Andrew. Let's say that they do a scan and they don't find any critical or high or even medium vulnerabilities. The application may still not satisfy the functional or non-functional requirements for quality.
Okay. So I guess in summary, you know, if you are, you can't have quality software without it being secure, but if it is secure, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's always going to be quality.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, let's talk now about some of the benefits. What are the benefits of fusing AppSec with QA?
Well, I think that the case for reframing security in relation to quality has never been stronger. Now's the time. And while security and quality aren't one and the same in the software development process, they do share, you know, undeniable connection. And the defect that manifests as a system fault today could be a vulnerability exploited by an attacker tomorrow. And by bringing the two together, quality and security, the result can help remove software risks and provide improved continuity.
Well, let's maybe look to the future now and talk about, you know, where do we start? So how do we actually go about combining AppSec and QA?
I think it helps if you actually define some of these standard non-functional security requirements that are expected for the applications to adhere to those. you know, for more agile or DevOps kind of situations, defining these misuse and abuse user stories. And some of these stories should be standard for all apps, and then you're going to have, you know, specific ones in the context of specific custom applications. And automate that security testing. It should be part of the core processes. And you want to do that as early as you can in the lifecycle to minimize the impact overall. But when development management recognizes that this works well together, the quality and security side, I think they'll be pleased with the results. And again, I think that the management measurements are very key points of alignment. If you can get your security metrics included or embedded into the measures, like the defect density one we were just talking about, that management tracks to those, that'll make a big difference. I saw this happen at Cox Automotive, that based in Atlanta, and they were struggling to get security defects remediated. And it wasn't until they actually were able to associate the defects with the quality metrics that the dev teams were measured by that they started to get the kind of attention they needed. And then the quality team took that on. They actually took on the need for tracking and helping remediate the security defects. So that was a big win for that specific customer.
Yeah, that's great. And, you know, sometimes I think it's just a matter of getting everybody on the same page, whether you have the security team, whether you have the QA team. And that's, like you said, I think that's where the metrics come in. That's something that can kind of unify everyone to a common goal.
Yeah.